You started in the spirit. Why did you end up in the
flesh?
And yesterday, we emphasized that some of us start in the spirit of God, then end up in the spirit of the evil one. Remember? And we call that the arc-out. The desire to get power, even when that power is not from God. Today, we want to say that that movement from beginning the spirit to end up in the flesh, sometimes it's not about the occult and magic. It's just about wrong teaching. You start okay, but somewhere along the way, you have teaching that is very strange. That's what you believe in. We call you a cult. Because there is something you are teaching that is not in the mainline biblical truth. You know, just I think 2 weeks ago, I was listening to somebody on OPEP, on one of the stations, and they were being questioned about marriage. And it sounded like the person answering was one of the leaders of the PCA church, one of the PCA churches. And they said, they were telling the listeners, you cannot expect God to choose a life partner for you. In fact, the argument was, if all of us waited for God to choose a life partner, what will happen when there are problems? God will get accused by too many people. He can't handle it. I said, and you know the person had started by saying how they got saved when they are young. Now, I was confused. Which scripture would you be reading to not know that we are supposed to walk in the
spirit?
And what does it mean to walk in the spirit? It means you don't make decisions except as by the spirit of
God.
And so you have people that may have attended the normal pre-Presbyterian teachings for new believers. They even have memorized the Bible. But somewhere along the way, they go to a teaching where you feel like as long as you don't smoke, you don't drink, you don't have to run after people's daughters or even their mothers, you're a good guy. Then God does not get involved with you on a daily
basis.
They do not believe that God intervenes. In fact, the way God has explained, God does not intervene with your decisions. You are left to decide to choose the wife. You know, and I said, why would I then need to become a Christian? If without Christ I can run my life, and with Christ I still run my life, do I need Christ? No. But that is, we are getting more and more people in the church who do not want to believe in walking in the Spirit, because they believe you read the Bible. After you've read the Bible, you do your own thing. But the truth is, in the book of Galatians, we are learning that to do that is to begin in the spirit and end in the flesh, because you are running your own life. What other teachings are there? And then you can find them, you can find many. I attended a church not recently who was speaking in the 1970s, in a church somewhere in Kiambu. And as we were in the vestry, the pastor, the leader, asked me, when did you get saved? I told him. Then he told me, you know me, I was saved before your mother was born. And obviously, that is 40 years ago. It's likely to be true. And I respected that idea that he had been saved for so long. When he came to the pulpit, he was the one making the announcement as the leader of the church. He told the people, with my ear, I always made fun of it, but I never imagined I could hear it in an announcement in the church. He announced, I have been checking the record of the giving by members. Those of you who are behind Maruta, you know, allocations, if you die, don't come here. Problems. How would you come there after your death? There is no risk possibility. But he don't have to frighten people to give more money. He told them he's going to do the book Yabaruta, the book of accounts for people's giving. And if you are not up to date, when you die, don't they account to church? That's you. You know, I was seated, of course, in traditional churches, there is a way you see. I feel like going under the table. I didn't imagine somebody who was saved before my mother was born has not read in the scriptures that that's not the way God will use to measure who is a Christian. Problem number two. It means he has changed the teachings about death. He has implied that what they do to your body after you are dead has spiritual consequences. And unfortunately, even among us, there are people whose reason for coming back to the church is to be buried by the church. But when I talk about you, do you know those such people? And somewhere, when people get to my age, I'm over 65. Even those who have never attended church, start attending church, so they can be buried. Now, my friends, whether you are buried by a church or buried by a mosque, if you are going to hell, you will have reached there before the burial. It do not matter what they are doing, but this who said, and that's more than 40 years ago, he died a long time ago, has a new teaching. He is still in a mainland church, but somehow over time, he has got a new teaching about the value of value. You know, and what the value can do. But you cannot find that information in the Bible. There is no information. The Bible says in Hebrews 9, it's appointed that the man want to die. After that,
judgment.
So from the moment Nana dies, there is no allowed time for you to do something for me to improve. It will be too late. Because as soon as I'm dead, I'm either on the hell side or heaven side. Nothing you do to my body will help me in any way. But he's warning people. Please, pay up. If you don't pay up, you will not be buried by the church. And if you're not buried by the church, there are consequences. My friend, there are no consequences of any nature.
But there's a teaching
that people end up with
that's not in the Bible.
That's what's happening. And I found a lot of churches, barriers are becoming bigger and bigger. You know, I can remember attending a barrio in the 1950s. I was not very big. I started primary school in 1953. So it's about that time. And those days, when you died, you are not coffins. They used to get a gunia. You know the gunia? You used in the village? Put the body in the gunia and then put in the soil. And I was wondering, why we do that? My grandfather told me that is progress. To be put in a gunia is progress. He told me when he was younger, you are not married at all. If you look like you are just about to die, they took you outside to die in the cold. Have you heard of those stories? That's how Kikuyus did it. But the church in the central province has gotten a new doctrine where barrio is getting more meaning than the scriptures give it. Am I communicating? So people are spending, you know, the other day I was going to attend a funeral, and they are literally counting millions of shillings, the budget. And it's not to pay the bill, it is various things. When my mother died, understanding the theology of the Bible, my mother died not too long ago in her 80s. And I was given the responsibility of looking for a coffee. And I called a friend of mine who knows Kamukuji down there. There's a place for coffins, those of you who have been involved. So I told him to take me. So he went there. I had not done recently anything about coffins, but they were lined up. Although that coffin is 5,000. That one is 10,000. That one is 20. This one is 8,000. I asked the seller, how can you tell the difference between the one of 5 and the one of 8? They say that's a very expensive tree. Second question, You have to worry whether they are again. Work on it. He said, no, no, not all of them are eaten, but they are the same way. So how do you value? And then, these people are so confusing. What they polish the one of 5,000, it looks exactly like the one of four there.
80,000.
Are you getting my point? So I told my friend, this is very confusing. Since I know my mother was born again, she is already gone with the Lord, why would I spend any more money than the cheapest coffin? So I said, I'll buy the most expensive, I'll buy 10,000. Ah, the guy said, you're gonna miss it, brother, mama, sure. You can't marry your mother in 10,000. I said, why? He said, what? I said, nothing to who? My mother. I'm getting my point. So if I had to negotiate, and you know what, it's my mother we are talking about, and he's not his mother, but he is the one negotiating for my mother to get a better coffee. I think he bought one for 15,000. And obviously, once my relatives saw it, they have no idea. They are not expert in coffee knowledge, you know? They have no idea how much money
of course.
I paid. And so it's my personal money, so it's not their money that I'm taking, because that duty has been given by my relatives. As I'm saying that, there are people here already disturbed. Hey, I hope my son is not here to do that. You have already said that your son is attending. You already checked. Has he come? How do you want him to hear this message? But show me from the scriptures where anything you do on the dead person has any. Remember, you are a spirit. Are you aware? Man is a spirit located in a body. Am I going to get it? This is not John Nana. You know this? This is not John Nana. This is the body of John Nana. John Nana is a spirit. When I relocate, I have a new location. This will not be any useful. It just dies. That's why you bury it. It's of no consequence. Are we together? Is that scripture?
Yes.
So you start asking yourself. So I remember we are talking about beginning in the spirit and in the flesh. And today I emphasize Celtic teachings, moving away from the mainline historical message of the Bible to some teachings that are gaining currency over time and in such a way that everybody accepted. The bishop, the prebend, the moderator accepted. That's now the new way of doing things. But they are not getting it from the Bible. So we, in this revival meeting, we are asking, what is it we currently are doing as a group and has become accepted in church? But in truth be told, we have left the line. We are no longer on the rail. Don't worry about the whole group. What about you? What are the things you are believing? You still claim to be born again, but there are things you are believing that don't quite follow the Bible. In America, one of the things that is a new currency is that it's okay to divorce. In 1997, I went to America for a Gideon. I'm a Gideon, we give Bibles. For a Gideon conference, and the Gideons were encouraged, the American Gideons were encouraged to host us for lunch during the conference, so we can report to them how the Gideon's work is going outside the US. The first day, I was hosted by an old man with his wife and his family. And so he introduced me. He said, hey, it's so good to meet you. And then he was in somebody in his 60s, I was around 40. So he said, this is my second wife. I was shocked. I do not know in America they are polygamous. So when you tell me this is my second wife, I was confused. But I was in Africa, we respect age. So I was unable to ask him, what do you mean? But the following day, again, I was taken out by somebody else. He said, this is my third wife. Now I feel sure, even if they get annoyed, I have to find out. How these and the Gideons are very conservative, serious Christians. How did you end up with a bad wife? That's why I asked, very respectfully. Say, no, 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 you don't understand. You know, I got married the first one, but she was tired of me and left me. Then I got the second one. I was tired of her, and so I left her. But look at what the Lord has given me. Then he said, this is my son who is not her son. And this is her daughter who is not my daughter. And this is now our son for both of us. Now it's a complex. Look at this.
Because of being introduced to the family.
That is 20 years ago. I don't know how it is now.
It has gotten to the level that many pastors
are divorcees. Am I communicating?
To the extent that the Bible is being translated
recently,
no longer want to translate Malachi chapter 2, which says God hates divorce. How can you write that verse? So they are looking for new Greek and new Hebrew. So they now don't say, and recheck some of the modern translations you are having, they don't say God hates divorce. It sounds like he's uncomfortable with it. You know how? Are you getting the point? So that you don't condemn the pastor. That's a chaotic thing. Because the Bible does not change. I'm getting my point. So I'm trying to tell you, when you talk about counts, do not think of them over there. There are many people who are counted and are pastors in our churches. Many people who are counted and are elders in our churches. They are two they follow, which they cannot find from the scriptures. And tonight we are saying, what are those truths? What is it that you believe in that cannot be found in the scriptures as we discuss cults? Let me first of all admit that cults are very many, even in our country. There are many of them. Some information I gathered as I'm preparing says that as of 2000, the top 10 world religions have included 99.4% of the world population. The main thing we have discovered is that there is enormous religious change going on across the world all the time. It's a massive, it's complex, and it's continuing. But David Barrett and Michael Jeffrey have identified 9,900 distinct and separate religions in the world, increasing by two or three new religions every day. And they are very serious on this subject. And I want to ask you the question, do you want to get the message I'm giving? Religions are many, but you need to understand the issue is not religion, it's what does the person teach. Denominations are many, but what should bother you is not the title of the denomination, it is what does it teach. And you need to understand, it is the point I'm giving you, that it is possible, very possible, for a traditional denomination to start becoming chaotic without surrendering. Am I communicating? And that's what is the issue. So you say, me, I don't go to other denominations. Stay there, and you'll still be counted within the denomination. Because the change is, when it becomes accepted by everybody, nobody will question the other. And that's why the main message of tonight is you have to read the Bible for yourself. If you are literate, do not wait for Nana to read for you. Because you see, Nana, when it becomes chaotic, you'll not even discover. Because you don't know what the man says is right, isn't it? So you end up in trouble. Because you don't need a Bible for yourself. My mother, whom I said died the other day, did not step inside the class, even on the wrong side of the classroom. But she was reading the Bible. When she got saved and she learned the value of Otegiwa Omodenya, the daily guide in Kikuyu. It was my responsibility every December to buy the daily guide and send it. That is the Christmas gift she expected to be given the daily guide. So when we all grew up and left home, what would she do? She would employ somebody working on the farm. Then tell them to come early, she will make tea for them. But that tea was in strings attached. When the boy arrives, and she's making tea for him before he starts work, my mother would get the daily guide. And I probably a guide, the new Bible says, this book, if you go to where the date of today is, it will tell you where to read in this other book. You know, the boy is not a Christian, he's just a worker. So, but for the tea, this is the way to pay for the tea. I'm getting the point. So he would read, he would go to sanctify the day, the day is clear. If it is April that year, he will see which passage to read. He will read it. Then my mother will give the commentary on what he has read. What in the process are you doing? Preaching to the young man. As he explains what you have read, then finally they will read the comment of the daily guide and pray together. Many boys within 6 months will be born again. But my mother knew the Bible. He kept saying, "Toreba only get them." Nahara to be to get them. He wondered, does this old lady ever read the Bible? Yes, it is in her head. Now the question is, you went to school. That's why you are listening to me in English. Oh, how would you be treated by my mother? Is it? I'm getting my point. And there are some seated here, it's like there are some seated here who do not have a daily guide. They read the Bible once in a while. They do not realize that if we are going to do the chaos and wrong teaching, we will need to have God's word in our heart. Please hear me this. People who give wrong teaching are in several categories. Some are new people who come with their teaching and they make it very attractive. And they are reading the same Bible. That is a risk. But in my mind, not a big risk. Because you don't know him, you're suspicious, isn't it? So when they say something, you can question. So a lot of people who end up in cowards are not in that group. The second group are people who have prophesied before and what they said came out to. So they taught you in Sunday school and you are what you are because of them. Then somewhere many years of walking with the Lord, they change their message. Because they have always said the truth, even now you assume it must be true. Those are the risky ones. And the ones we need to be careful about. Because when your own pastor or moderator takes a corner, it's very difficult to tell. Am I communicating? And yet, in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 14, you know chapter 11, 12, 13, and 14, it's talking about the spiritual gifts. 13 is about the fruit of the Spirit called love. Chapter 14 says, and it's talking about the various gifts of the Spirit, says, in a meeting, let two or three of you prophesy. And what are the others to do?
Interpret.
Have you read the Bible? In a meeting, it should not be full of prophecies. Two or three are inadequate. But then it says, let two or three prophesy. And the others?
Interpret.
Hey, you haven't read that one. Please go and read 1 Corinthians chapter 14 tonight. It's an assignment before you sleep. It says, and the others weigh. What they are? Saying. The person you are weighing may be him, or may be your pastor. But you must weigh him. Not because he wants. It's a command. That let the prophet prophesy. Ah, that's okay. But it's the work of the others to weigh. So the responsibility not to let up in account does not belong to another the preacher. It belongs to the congregation. I don't know why God was so, because people said, he misled me. Well, why are you being misled? The responsibility to follow is yours. Am I communicating? So, the book of 1 Corinthians 14 is saying, you are the problem. The prophet may have done an error, but why didn't you? We. 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 to 4. It says, test the spirits to see whether they are from God. What does that mean? If you are going to test the spirits, you are taking the risk of testing the Holy Spirit. Because you see, you are testing every spirit to see whether from God. In the process, there will be testing the Holy Spirit. But some of us preachers, we say you must not touch the Lord's
anointed.
Anointed. You ask them the question, Pastor, why did you say that? Don't you know you are talking to the Lord's
anointed?
Can you get it?
has instructed us.
In case you think that's a corner, go back to the letters of John, and John is saying, eight parables from the Spirit to test the Spirit. Even in the process, you will discover Nana was speaking by the Spirit of God. But you are not supposed to take what Nana says, even what Nana is saying just now. You have not listened, accepting it without testing. You must test. That's a command from the Spirit. And tonight's message is to emphasize to you. You know, the other day I was talking to a couple, and I don't know what the wife had said. And then the husband told me, but you know, the Holy Spirit told her, who am I to ask? Say, have you ever read the Bible? Says, no, the church, they are there, a church with our God's account, has taught them to walk by the Spirit. And to walk by the Spirit means whatever you have already. And if the pastor speaks and says the Spirit told him, you have no right to question the Lord's
commandment. Anointed.
But you know, when I share, because I read the Bible, because you can see this from the young believer, it's an old believer. When I read the Bible, I said, you know, brother, no, I have never read that. The teaching I have is on the Holy Spirit speaks. You must do what the Holy Spirit says. So I asked, just check what your wife told you. Is it in line with the scripture? But you know, brother, no, you can't do that. It's the Spirit talking. I say, the Spirit doesn't contradict himself. And the Bible is a writing by God's inspiration. Are we together? So when your wife says, the Holy Spirit blessed me to divorce you, now ask her. Malachi chapter 2, verse 15. God hates divorce. So the Spirit that told you to divorce me, you know where it came from. So if you agree with him, you are on your way to hell with him. Am I communicating? It's important to understand. So the responsibility, not whether an account, does not belong to the pastor or the moderator. It belongs to you. It belongs to you to test every spirit. And my emphasis now is every spirit, not the spirit. Number the second emphasis is you test even the ones who have been right. All the world, you test your own husband, whom you have already trusted, who has helped you in the faith. Because when the devil comes, he has no selections. Am I communicating? And if he really wants to get you, he can't get you from demonic people. He will get you through people you trust. Would you agree with me?
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what you're learning tonight. If you don't want to end up walking the flesh, you must test the spirit. But then what? How do you test the spirit? There must be a measure. And the measure is clear. It's what God has already said. Okay, to my point? So, you are supposed to read the Bible from cover to cover. So that when Yana speaks, you feel, hi, what am I saying? I can't remember reading the Bible. And like the message in Acts chapter 17, where there are people called Bereans. Paul says the Bereans were noble. Why? Whatever Paul preached was not accepted. Every evening, they checked whether it was true. Many of the churches are not Bereans. And that's why you are finding even traditional churches taking new teachings that are not in the scriptures. All people who have been in the wrong for a long time, taking an agent and joining cults because they have not learned the word of God. The psalmist says, thy word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. And so you need to understand, if you are not going to end up in a cult, you cannot read the Bible once in a while. You cannot read only part of the Bible. You must read the whole Bible. I keep challenging young people. You find a young person with a big novel. I ask him, young man, you know, in our time, God, with Grain of Wheat was one of the biggest novels. Now, the one you're reading, you find 2,300 pages, one novel. I say, when you finish it? Look at this, in 2 weeks. But you know, the novel is bigger than the Bible. You know, some of the novels you're reading, the number of pages is bigger than the Bible. And you ask him, have you ever read the Bible from cover to cover? Oh no. The devil has convinced people that the Bible cannot be read
from cover
fully. But the novel can be read fully. And the novel is spoiling their mind. And the Bible is correcting their mind. They have opted for their mind to be corrupted. Okay, to my point? And let me ask you, anybody who has been saved for a year, by now, should have covered the Bible from cover to cover. You have been saved like me 50 years, or maybe 5 years, or maybe 3 years. And up to now, they are part of the Bible. When a cult teaches it, I have never heard that. Oh my God, I never thought. Now, pastor is secondary. You are the one who is a disciple, and a disciple is a student. How come you have not read the Bible from cover to cover? How will you hope to weigh the cult leaders when you have only read the New Testament? The Bible is not the New Testament. The Bible is both the old and the new. It's a matter you ask, and I'm grateful to the Lord for the person who came to my high school in 1968. Told me the importance of covering the Bible from cover to cover. And so I have consistently, that way I helped my mother to start reading. I was told that if I followed the daily guide, in 6 to 7 years, I would have gone only 15 to 20 minutes every morning, but I would have covered the Bible from cover to cover. And so in the last 15 years, I have no idea how many times I have covered the Bible. And it helps me. When I read a book, and I say something I've never heard. The first thing is what I've never heard. I'm not suggesting it's wrong. I want to go and verify the scriptures. Are we together? And you need to understand, if you are not reading the Bible consistently, you discover yourself believing straight things, practicing straight things, having started in the spirit, you are going to end up
in the flesh.
All because you are not spending enough time with God's word. You know, I want to ask, why do we end up in cults? Number one, because the devil is the father of lies. John chapter 8, verse 44. And Jesus put it in very graphic language. He says, when the devil lies, he is speaking his native
language.
You know what, it would be strange for you to talk another language. So, and because he is like that, the moment you are born again, everyone, he decides, I'll follow her. And because I cannot make her backslide, I'll make her cute. And you know something? If you are going on a long journey, and maybe you are an aircraft, and you miss by 0.5 degree offline, and you go for 3 hours, will you end up where you are going? No. And that's what he does. Because he's the father of lies. When he called our mother Eve, he didn't go contradicting God completely. He just said, did God say, you will not eat every tree? Now, obviously God had said, you don't eat that tree, isn't it? But he doesn't want, so he began with the truth and put doubt in the mind of Eve. Eve failed and her husband followed. And unfortunately, the devil is not very original. Up to now, it's the same thing counter-heading. They start with a teaching that's biblical. So biblical, you follow them. Then they start tilting by a small percentage. So small, you don't feel like you're disturbed. Because of that small one, within no time, you will discover yourself completely out of line. And my brother, my sister, you need to ask yourself, are you moving off the line? Are you being helped in a lie? The only solution, I repeat, is for you to know the word of God from cover to cover. And not once, continuously. Even where I read this morning, I'm reading it, and it sounds like I've never read again. That's why I know God's word is the living one. Because after reading all the things I've read, every time I'm reading, I find a new message. Is that true of you? You need to understand. So you don't say, I have now read from cover to cover. You continuously hide God's word in your heart. That way you will not end up sinning or going on. So the first reason why people go join cults is because cults are like the airport that are going for power elsewhere. Here is doctrinal. They just start teaching something 99% is exactly the same thing you teach. Then they put, start putting 1%. And that's the message of John 8:44 or Genesis 3:4. Number two, why do people end up in cults? Due to sin, charismatic individuals use religion to feed their pride, passion, and possessions. In other words, here, the problem is the leader. He starts the right teaching. The realities, the structures of the church are controlling him. There was somebody called Jim Jones in a place called Guyana. Those of you who are over 40 years will remember the story. When it appeared in the Times magazine, it was people sleeping in families, all dead, and nobody killed them. They all committed suicide. The story we read is, this was a normal preacher in America, teaching normal things, and he attracted many people. Then he started teaching, small change. He was teaching graduates, educated people. And so he taught them that he's going to give them the experience of New Testament faith. And then he said, in order to experience it, to make a colony in Northern South America, in Guyana. And when they make that colony, they will live as New Testament believers. The Time magazine tells us he reached a level where he stopped preaching by the Bible. You see, you can't keep looking at this when the man of God is talking. So the Bible was kept down. As soon as the Bible is kept down, Chochote Chaweza could okay. So they got to a level where, because many parents had lost their young people, their mother was discussing the Congress in the US. And they said, no, Congress must follow the matter. And of course, they hear from the international news. He started training these educated people that surely, instead of our peace being disturbed, isn't it better to die? And by that time, they trusted him fully. All said yes. So he started organizing mock deaths. In other words, learning how to die. He organized for poison to be drunk. Then he lined them up. He said, I hear they are coming. These are time to take the poison. They all line up. They take, each person takes a little poison. Then they don't die. He says, we are just practicing. Over time, they now are ready for it. One day, the plane of the congressman was in train. It was for him. He now put real poison. And they brought themselves in families, mother, father, and children. And they all, with a ladder, everybody is giving them poison. They would take the poison, go and lie on the grass, clean grass. Those of you who remember seeing it in Time magazine. And they were photographed, all of them, in a ground dead, not anybody murdering them. And those kind of cults have come to Nairobi. Have you heard of them? They are in Nairobi. You need to understand it clearly, unless you know the Bible, so that you can tell the father is going off the line. You end up with a teaching that will get you into serious, serious trouble. Why is that? Because man is sinful. Because man is sinful, as soon as you trust a man, you will have in trouble. You need to understand one of the most dangerous things that's currently happening is what I referred to yesterday. Where a lot of us want to worship without our head. It sounds like in a proper good worship place, you are supposed to leave your head outside and come inside. So you just praise the Lord without thinking what you are doing. That's why now worship leaders can make you do anything. They can tell you, jump with one leg. Where is the Bible? Did they say you jump with one leg? But all of us jump with one. Greet your neighbor from the left. Greet your neighbor on the right. Why? It's not necessary. The other day I was preaching in one of the universities and I couldn't believe what I had. We had gone with a team of people, one a pilot, the other one an engineer, the other one an economist. So we wanted to make a panel. During the worship time, the worship leaders told us to do funny things. And then after some time he said, it is very interesting. If you are out there and I told you to do it, you can't agree to do it. But in the Christian union, I have power over you. Can you imagine? He's telling us. But he has made us do funny things.
He is telling us he has power over us.
And then after that, he told us two things. Of course, now I refuse.
Now, you need to understand. You need to understand.
I don't want to be wrong that he has reached a level where he can tell you that in the Christian religion, you don't use your brain. And he's telling you and you are laughing and
rejoicing.
I'll get to my point. That's the beginning of joining a cult. The moment you cannot question the worship leader, cannot question the pastor, cannot question the preacher, is the beginning. That's the point you reach, where God cannot use your mind to question. Because once you are born again, your mind is rendered to God, isn't it? Have the mind of Christ, Ephesians chapter 2. It means you think with the mind of Christ. You have hidden God's word in your mind, and God will use the mind. So you need to understand the moment your mind is entered. And in my book, one of the books being sold there, the stewardship on stewardship, I've talked about the stewardship of the mind. And I'm arguing in the book, you cannot be educated by God's gift, then behave like you've never gone to school. That is bad stewardship of the education God gave you. You cannot sit there for God to read the Bible for you when you are illiterate. That is bad stewardship of the education God gave you. So you need to understand, in these Celtic tendencies, the basic thing is stop thinking. But I told you yesterday, God does not want to be worshipped one. He wants all the three. Your mind, your body, and your spirit. Must all worship. That means the mind must get involved. And you must never, ever surrender your brain in any congregation. Because if you do, you're not obeying God. God wants you to come with your brain. Are we together? And hear it. But then your brain is not an unchristian brain. Your brain must be surrendered to God so that He can help you to think like God wants. So what is the second reason people are going natural? It's because of what we are saying. Man has gotten interested in controlling others, and then we have become controllable because we no longer use our brain. Thirdly, and importantly, cultic leaders exploit doctrines and truths neglected by the church, or play off them with half truths. Because the church hasn't taught correct doctrine well, Christians sometimes are beguiled by popular leaders who beguile them with sweet lies. You know, like we talk about the mystery of the Trinity. You know, when you go among the witnesses, there's no mystery. They explain it very easily. One of the ways of knowing God is that they have no complicated things. For them, everything is simple. The other day, I was trying to talk to a Jehovah's Witness, and they said, the Bible here talks about Christ. It talks about the Father. Talks about the Holy Spirit. And the Bible referring to them as God. And yet, the Bible is telling us, there's only one God. How can you say that? Of course, what they do is, they decide that Jesus is not God. He's just an angel. Because God is only one. I say, but you can't say that. Go to the place where Jesus is baptized. And at the time he is baptized, God the Father says, this is my beloved Son. And that voice is not physically on the water. God the Son is in there. So how can you say they are the same? As if that's not enough, the Holy Spirit comes as a dove. So all the three are operating in the same time. So you cannot start saying they are the same. And yet you are not allowed to say they are many. That's what we call it, the mystery of
Trinity.
But you have the Jehovah's Witnesses making it look, now all you need is to remove Jesus from this Godhead. Then you can understand it. Then the Marian Branham people are the other extreme. Whereas the Jehovah's Witnesses accept, they agree, but lowers Jesus to become human or angel. The Marian Branham people, the end-time believers, are the other way around. They say for them, they believe the three are one. In other words, the name of God is Jesus. I don't think you have read their books. According to them, there are three offices. There's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
but they are all one, operating in different dispensations. Are you getting the point?
Again, you ask, all the three operated at the baptism.
Am I communicating?
But you're trying to make it. So what you are saying is, a lot of the cults exploit the what we call mysteries by trying to demystify it. If you want to remain a Christian, you must agree with Paul in 1 Corinthians 13. He says, now I see through a mirror.
Exactly.
Now I ask Shua, the great apostle, who wrote two-thirds of the New Testament, you mean you didn't understand?
Paul is a converse.
There are things I don't understand. And yet Paul had gone to the third heaven. But he says, up to now, I have remained limited. I don't understand. My friend, if you don't want to wrap in account what God has not revealed, let it remain unrevealed. Mark communicating. Don't try to simplify. Repeat God's word as it is, even when you can't explain it. Because you need to understand that this is God's word. You are human. And the creator may not fully understand. The creation may not fully understand. The creator.
Mark communicating.
And you need to understand the cults are specializing there. But the point I have made is the church may be contributing. Lack of teaching. So, and when they teach certain places, not everything. Whereas God's word is clear, those who get it go to the whole world to bring the gospel. Those who believe, teach. Whatsoever I'm talking, what has happened? Three problems. Number one, many pastors are in their own profession. They are great evangelists. So Sunday number one, they tell you to get saved. Sunday number two, they get to tell you to get converted. Sunday number three, they tell you to get God, they get redeemed. Sunday number four, they tell you to come to Jesus. But in reality, it's the same sermon repeated in four times. Am I communicating? They are interested in getting saved. After they are saved, the one who God said 10 years ago, one of them now have the same information. Because we are not spending time teaching how proud I am about the Presbyterian Church, which realized there is a problem with the teaching, especially in Central Province, about how a Christian relates with his traditions. So they met in a general conference and issued a statement, the first church to make a stand. And yet the problem has been here with us in several years. Am I right? That's why you have ended up with the pastors who have given the vote. Have you seen them? You have seen 16 PCMF leaders who have given the vote, and the church, they say nothing about it. So we have ended up with a cult. In some program, there is a cult of people who are in church leadership, but also believe in ancestral worship. They are in both. So they believe you must get baptized. They believe and they are leaders in the church. But at the same time, they believe. If you have not, if you have not done burial and cut the shoulder, your marriage is not yet blessed. Now, you can't understand how. And you know that's a count. I told you a count may be 99% okay. It only misses around 1%. And obviously, when you fear a Christian, who believes marriage is blessed because of blood, you know he is lost. Are we together? Even if 99% he is sitting alone, the right thing, this particular one is not scripture. Why? The Jerusalem Council in Acts chapter 15, and went through it with men the last time I was here, or even deals with the matter of how to treat traditions and beliefs. So, but they have slowly, I don't know how it was done, but the devil is really coming. How he was able to get church leaders to become traditional worshippers. You find a pastor, and when they are in that ceremony with others, he is the one facing Mount Kenya, and I ask him, my friend, you are worshipping the God of Kirinyaga? Yes. I thought when you became a Christian, you believe in the God of all mountains. How can you devote yourself to the level of one mountain? Surely, the God of one mountain is not worth worshiping when you know the God of all mountains. But you can't see it because he's a pastor, he's a moderator, and that's what he believes. The then others follow along the line. Are you getting how simple it is to go about it? Very proud with the General Assembly that met, I think in April, I don't know when they met, I read it in the Nation newspapers. That made us stand. As soon as made us stand, every Kikuyu station is attacking the moderator. Have you seen that? Making fun of him. Back I had somebody saying, if the Lord has 20 goats, let's say 30 eating cows. Now, in other words, they think the church is discouraging people from eating meat. Of course, it's a joke to make the church look funny. But unless a church makes a stand, the people will be lost and they will be partly the reason. So when you talk about people going into cults, part of it is because the church is not teaching the whole gospel. It's only teaching certain aspect of the gospel. So you do not bother to talk about culture. What is going on? You know it is happening there. You know, somebody said, and I have to be finishing, somebody said, a good pastor, a good preacher, always has the newspaper in the hand, one hand,
the Bible.
And the Bible with the other. Pastors who have the Bible, they don't have newspapers, have a wonderful message, but it is irrelevant. Because they are not scratching where it is?
Itching.
Pastors whose only relevance is the newspaper, they become political. Am I right? So you need a pastor who is reading the newspapers to get what is current in his congregation and then go to the Bible to find the answer to the problem he feels so upsetting. And if people are doing that, you will not end up with people ending up in traditional worship without any pastor making a stand about it. Because you have read it in the newspaper, you have heard it from the articles, you have heard it from grandfathers, you have heard it. Then you go to the Bible to find out what the Bible says, and you teach the Bible. That does not mean some people will not be lost, but you will not be held accountable. Ezekiel was sold. If there is a danger coming, I have made you a watchman. If you tell the people about the danger, but they refuse to listen to you, they will die, but their blood will not be required out of your hands. Are we together? So you need to understand. It's unfortunate, my time is up. But you can understand, we are now, yesterday we were talking about the occult and the power of witchcraft and things like that. But you're not talking about doctrine and ending up in a cult, simply but moving a little. Question mark. Are you already in a cult? Like being part of this church? But the truth is, your belief system is starting to move. Where are you? Let's pray. Again, I want to give you a moment to interact with the Holy Spirit. Outside my words, what did you hear the Holy Spirit say to you? Is there something He is pointing to in your life that needs to change? Are there beliefs which the Holy Spirit is saying, that is not from me? My suggestion to you is, come to where with your God, forgive me. Because Christ died on the cross, so whoever had made their sin, they can be forgiven. When you talk about thy word have I hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Are you in the category that studies God's word daily? Are you in the category that reads the Bible helicopter view from cover to cover? Or are you the person who is a Sunday Christian? Only read the Bible after reading it. So they cannot check the pastor because they themselves don't have God's word. Would like to God and tell God, forgive me. I intend to commit myself to the study of the Bible on a daily continuous basis until you call me home. But I need your help. Forgive me for the past. Take over now. Just tell the Lord, talk to the Lord that you really want to follow the straight and the narrow. You do not end up in a cult. You want to be revived to a commitment to New Testament Christianity and to following biblical faith. As I pray, would you like you and me, the Bible says, if two of you agree concerning anything, that I will do. Would you like to show by your hand that as I pray, I should include you in prayer? There is something you are telling God, and as you put up your hand, you know what you are telling God. It's a sign you need His help, and I join you in the prayer. Would you like to put up your hand up high? The Lord bless you. Put the hand up. The Lord bless you, put it down. The Lord bless you, put it down. The Lord bless you, put the hand down. The Lord bless you, put the hand down. You are telling God, as I put this hand up, I've heard the message. I want my life to change. I want to enjoy my walk with you. But I want to walk in the straight and the narrow. I want to be able to say no to the teachings of the devil so that I can stick with God's word. Don't put up a second time. But there anybody else? Yeah, the Lord bless you, the Lord bless you, the Lord bless you, the Lord bless you, put the hand down, the Lord bless you. Anybody else just before I pray? The Lord bless you. Lord Jesus, all these men and women are crying to you. And I want to join them. Because the Bible says, if two of you agree concerning anything, that I will do. I want to agree with them. That you are a gracious God. You are a merciful God. It doesn't matter how far we move away from the center. You are able to return us back to your center. It doesn't matter what count we have joined. You are able to help us back onto the line. And as they put their hand, I want to join them in agreeing we are a forgiving God. And I pray that every one of them will be cleansed by the blood of Jesus. But secondly, we want to seek your help to commit ourselves to God's word, to the reading of it, to the obeying of it. And as they put their hand, they are saying, God, help me to love your word. And so to follow it. And I pray that for everyone who put up their hand, you will make them committed to sacrifice in other areas so they can create time for studying your word. But thirdly, they need the Spirit to talk to them so they will listen to your voice as your Spirit helps to interpret what your word is saying in the scriptures and help them to test all that they hear from the preachers. So meet us at the point of our need. Thank you, Lord, that you answer our prayers and that for everyone who put up our hands, we walk out of this church forgiven and on our way to heaven. In Jesus' name we pray.